So in the last class, we have started discussing the frequency response of a MOS amplifier. And in connection to that, we have identified the different capacitors, internal capacitors, in fact, which are responsible for tuning the high frequency response of MOS amplifier. And in particular, we have discussed about the high frequency response of common source stage. Now today, I'll be talking about the frequency response of common drain amplifier and the common gate amplifier. Now to start with, let me first draw the circuit diagram for a common drain amplifier, which is also known as a source follower circuit. Now let me start with the common drain amplifier with the simplest possible biasing arrangement. So since the drain terminal is considered to be common, so therefore it is connected to VDD, which is also known as the AC ground, and the input is applied at the gate terminal, at the gate end. Suppose there is a resistance, and the output is obtained from the source end. Now suppose there is a current source kind of load and output side, and ideally speaking, the output impedance of this current source load is pretty large, and we'll be taking the output from this end. So this is the output terminal, that is V out, and in fact we are applying the input over here. And suppose this is the resistance, let me call this resistance to be RG. And we have a drain supply over here, that is VDD. Now, right now, we are not bothered about the magnitude of the current source, assuming that the value is pretty large. So the output impedance can be considered to be infinite over here. Now, first of all, in order to identify the high frequency response, we need to locate the different capacitors which are present over here. Internal capacitors. So as discussed in the last class, so one capacitor is connected between the gate terminal and the source terminal, which is known as CGS. So this is the capacitor which is connected between gate and the source. So I'm mentioning it once again that this is not externally connected, but the effect of this capacitor can be seen because of the structure of the MOS device. Now then we have another capacitor between the gate end and the drain end, which we call like CGD, gate to drain capacitor. And then we do have two other capacitor, one between the source and the bulk, source and the substrate, which is equal to CSB. And the last one is CDV. So these are the four capacitors, CDV, for a common drain amplifier, a common drain stage, which is also known as source follower because the output will follow the input over here. And there is no phase difference between the output and the input. So the basic idea behind this common drain amplifier has already been discussed in unit 3. Now, in this particular unit, we will be interested in looking at the frequency response, the high frequency response of this common drain amplifier. Now, having drawn the different capacitors over here, now, first of all, we have to identify whether any of the capacitors can be thrown away and whether there is any possibility of merging any of the capacitors. So let me start from CGS. So CGS is connected between the gate end and the source end. So gate is input terminal and source is output terminal. So as you understand, there is a Miller effect existing between these two terminals because of the presence of CGS. What about CSB? So this is connected between the source and the AC ground, and source is not at AC ground because source is the output terminal here for a common drain amplifier. So CSB will be existing over here. What about CGD? So this is connected between the gate and the drain. And as you understand, drain is connected to VDD, that is the supply line. So therefore, drain is kept at EC ground. Therefore, this particular capacitor will be existing between the gate end and the EC ground. And what about this capacitor, that is CDB? Now, as you understand, this is connected between the drain and the bulk. And drain is already connected to VDD, that is the AC ground, and bulk is also AC ground. So therefore, we can simply get rid of this capacitor. So we can get rid of this capacitor CDB in the small signal equivalent circuit. And we have to proceed with these three capacitors, that is CGS, CSB, and CGD. Now with this, let me just draw the small signal equivalent circuit first. Now we are applying the input at the gate end. So the input is connected between the gate terminal and So the input is connected between the gate and the ground. And also we do have a resistance over here between the supply, I mean the input signal and the gate end. So this one is V in, and here you have RC. Now from gate to drain, you have one capacitor, which is equal to CGD, and drain is already at AC ground. So therefore, from this end to ground, we do have CGD. And between gate to source, we do have CGS, and source is the output terminal here. So between gate to source, we do have this capacitor, and source is the output terminal here. So this one is CGS. And let me call that this difference equal to V1. Then obviously, there will be a voltage dependent current source, which we can regard like GM times V1. That is there between the drain and the source. And in fact, this end of the drain, it should be connected to AC ground. So this is the source end. And between source to ground, there is another capacitor, that is CSB. So this one is CSB. And potential here is Vout. So that is the small signal equivalent circuit. So here we have deliberately get rid of the output impedance, assuming that this R0 value is pretty large. So it can be neglected, because if it is not neglected, then this R0 should be there in parallel with GMV1. But assuming that the value of R0 is pretty large, so we can simply neglect this R0 in this small signal equivalent circuit. Then we have completed the small signal circuit involving these three capacitors, CGD, CGS, and CSB. And we do have this voltage dependent current source. So now we have to first identify these two nodes. So let me call this node as the node X, which is the gate end, and suppose this is the node Y. Now we have to apply KCL at node X and node Y, and accordingly, we have to find out the transfer function of this overall system, which is nothing but the ratio of Vout upon Vin as a function of S. So to do that, first you apply KCL at node X. Now if we do that, so here the potential is V in with respect to ground, and here the potential at X with respect to ground is this much. Potential at X with respect to ground is this one plus this one. So from X to Y, the difference is V1, and from Y to ground, the difference is Vout. So therefore, the potential at X with respect to ground is V1 plus Vout. So across the resistance RG, At one end, you have Vin, and on the other end, you have V1 plus Vout. So you can simply write down the expression. The voltage difference is Vin minus V1 plus Vout divided by RG, that is the current flowing through the resistance. And that should be equated to the current through these two. So here you can understand that this current is nothing but V1 times S CGS, because the impedance provided by this capacitor CGS is nothing but 1 upon S CGS. So the current is nothing but the voltage drop divided by the impedance. So V1 upon 1 upon SCGS. So that will give you V1 into SCGS. That is quite straightforward. And what about this? Now here, once again, the potential with respect to ground is V1 plus Vout. And here the impedance is 1 upon SCGD. So we can simply write this as plus V1 plus Vout times SCGD. So that we obtain by applying KCL at node X, and then what you can do is we can apply KCL at node Y. Now it suggests that if I assume that the current that is entering is GMV1 from this branch, and the current that is entering through this branch is nothing but V1 plus Vout into SCGD. This current is V1 into SCGS. This current is V1 into SCGS. That means this component, V1 into SCGS plus GM times V1. Now these two current, the summation of these two current is equal to the current through this. So we can easily write GM V1 plus V1 times SCGS is equal to V out times SCSP. Now from this equation, we can simply relate V1 with V out. So if I take V1 outside, it will give us GM plus SCGS. That is equal to V out into SCSP. So therefore V1 is equal to SCSP divided by GM plus SCGS into Vout. Now this transfer function based approach will give us the exact expression for the transfer function. On the other hand, if we just consider the nodal analysis by finding out the pole frequency at each node, then it will give us some approximate result. So this transfer function based analysis will give us the exact frequency response for this particular circuit. So anyway, so let us proceed. So already we have equated V1 as a function of Vout, and what we can do is we can simply substitute this one in this equation, the first equation. So let me just go to the next slide, and we can keep this Vin upon RG in one side. We can keep this one in one side and the rest of the part in the other side. So that is equal to V1 plus Vout upon RG. And plus we have V1 into SCGS, V1 into SCGS plus V1 plus Vout into SCGD. So from that, what we can do is we can take V1 common. So if I take V1 common, then we have 1 upon RG plus SCGS plus SCGD. Plus, we do have the other two component, that is, if I take V out common, we have 1 upon RG plus SCGD. So now you can simply replace, the substitute the value of V1 over here. So V1 was given by SCSB by GM plus SCGS into V out. So V1 was SCSB divided by GM plus SCGS into V out. Into V out, so I can write V out over here. And in bracket, we have this component. This, if I take S common, then you have CGS plus CGD, and plus you have V out 1 upon RG plus SCGD. Now what we can do is we can simplify this expression. So it's a big expression involving the second order polynomial in S. So in the numerator we have something. So let us check what is there in the numerator. Before that, let us just work out in the denominator. So what we can do is we can have this RG into GM plus SCGS in the denominator. Then obviously V out is there everywhere, so we can take V out outside. And let us try to understand what is there in the numerator only. So we can take RG common from this side. So what is left is SCSB into 1 plus SRG into CGS plus CGD. That is coming from the first term. And what about the second term? Now from the second term, we do have let me just write it down over here. That is GM plus SCGS gets multiplied with 1 plus SCGD. That's all. So now in the right hand side, we have this expression. So this RG can be cancelled from the left hand side and the right hand side. So then what we can do is we can simply write V out upon V in, because these two RG can be cancelled, this one and this one. So V out upon V in. So in the numerator, you have now in the numerator, you have GM plus SCGS because it will go up. So GM plus SCGS and in the denominator, what you have is you have to identify the coefficient of a square. So here you have one square term and you have another square term over here. I think there is I have missed one RG term over here. I have missed one RG. Because whenever you're multiplying this one with RG, so it will be like 1 plus S RG CD, CGD. So here is another A square. So if we take A square outside, then what you have is RG is obviously there. And then the cross product of these three different capacitors, that is CSB, CGS, plus CSB, CGD, plus CGS, CGD. So you have three different capacitors, CSB, CGS and CGD, and this is the cross product of two capacitors taking together. So that is the coefficient for A square. And what is left for S? Let us just identify what is left for S. So you have this term. So you have three terms for S. If I take this common, so you have CSB plus this term, that is CGS, plus this term. GMRG, CGD, plus obviously the constant term, that is GM. Now that is the overall transfer function. So what you can do is you can simply divide the numerator and denominator by GM in order to represent the entire thing in the form of A square plus BS plus 1. Because the constant here is not equal to 1, it is GM. So what we can do is we can simply divide the numerator and the denominator by GM. And then ultimately, what we can write is the transfer function H of S for a common drain source. So this is nothing but, in the numerator you have initially GM plus SCGS hopefully. Yes, so now we can simply divide this by GM. So it will be like SCGS by GM. And we have A square RG by GM multiplied with CGD, CGS plus CGD, CSB plus CSB, CGS. And the coefficient of S is given by, so if I take this GM common, it will be CSB plus CGS upon GM. CSB plus CGS upon GM plus the second term is RG CGD. This term is RG CGD. RG CGD plus 1. So that is all about the transfer function of a common drain stage. Here you have, now if you just closely look at the transfer function, now you see that you have a polynomial of A square in the denominator and a polynomial of S in the numerator. So you do have two poles and one zero. Now if you just closely look at the coefficients of A square and S, then you see that it's basically a function of the different capacitors like CGD, CGS, CSB, and so on. And obviously, it's a function of RG and GM. Now, if you just compare this expression with what we have already got in the last day, if you can remember, because of the Miller magnification between the input and the output terminal, the effective value of the capacitor was increased at the input node. And as a matter of fact, you do have 1 plus GM RG times the capacitor. And that capacitor was CGS, which was connected between the gate and the source. So for a common source stage, gate was considered to be the input terminal and the source was considered to be the output terminal. Sorry, for a common source, the gate is considered to be the input terminal and the drain is considered to be the output terminal. Source is common. So that capacitor was CGD. It's not CGS, rather it was CGD, which was connected in between the input and the output. And this time we have this capacitor, CGS. In this particular case, we have CGS, which is connected between the input and the output. So once again, you can already know what is meant by the Miller theorem, and you can also apply the Miller theorem over here. But you know that in case of a common drain kind of topology or source follower kind of topology, the maximum value of the voltage gain is equal to 1. In fact, because of the impairments, the actual value of the voltage gain is less than 1. So we can consider the voltage gain to be like close to 0.8 or 0.9 for a common drain or source follower kind of circuit. So if you just apply the Miller theorem over here, the component of CGS at the input side between the X to ground, it will not be multiplied by some factor. Rather, it will be reduced because the factor 1 minus A is now becoming like 0.1 or 0.05, depending upon the exact value of the gain. Now the gain is not equal to 1. Let me consider the gain is equal to 0.8 or 0.85 or 0.9. So depending upon the exact value of the gain, the low frequency gain, what you're talking about, the 1 minus A term will be pretty small, unlike the common source stage, in which case we have seen that the gain, if I just consider the magnitude of the gain, it was like GM times RD, and 1 minus AV was equal to 1 plus GM times RD, and that value is large with respect to 1. And this time, the effect of the capacitor CGS at the input node, it will be simply 0.1 CGS, that means 10% or 5% of CGS. So there will be no Miller magnification taking place over here for a common drain kind of topology. And therefore, in the final expression also, we do not find any GM RD type of product. So therefore, these two poles, if we can consider that this form is A square plus BS plus 1, can be written like 1 plus S upon omega P1. In fact, we are very much familiar with this form. We can write like, suppose in the numerator, you have some function AS. And in the denominator, we can write like 1 plus S by omega P1 and 1 plus S by omega P2. So that's why we have represented this denominator polynomial in this particular form, with 1 being the constant. So then you find that the coefficient of S squared is equal to 1 upon omega P1 omega P2, coefficient of S is equal to 1 upon omega P1 plus 1 upon omega P2, and the 1 is there. So now you do have two unknowns, omega P1 and omega P2, and you can equate it to these two terms accordingly, and you can easily find out the value for omega P1 and omega P2. But that calculation is not that simple this time, because last time we have made a dominant pole kind of approximation. That means we have assumed that, okay, let us assume that one pole is far away as compared to the other pole. So last time we have made an assumption that because of the Miller magnification, the effective value of the capacitor at the input node to ground was pretty large as compared to the effective value of the capacitor between the output node and the ground. And because of this fact, the RC time constant at the input node was small. I mean, perhaps you can remember that. Let me just once again write it down. The omega P1 can be written like C1 upon RC at say node 1, and omega P2 can be written like 1 upon RC. Obviously, so instead of writing node 1, I think it will be better if I write like instead of writing R. It will be better if I write like R1 C1. So R1 C1 and R2 C2. So if I associate this frequency, this pole frequency to the output node, then you find that for a common source stage, the effective value of the capacitor is not that large because there was no such Miller magnification. In fact, the effect of CGD at the output node was like 1 minus A inverse times CGD. And since A is pretty large, therefore A inverse is very small. And 1 minus A inverse CGD can be approximated to simply CGD. So at the output node, there was no effect of Miller magnification. So we can always apply Miller's theorem at the output node for a common source stage. But that time, the effective capacitance was not increased. So as a matter of fact, the RC time constant was small at the output node. And since RC time constant was small, so omega P2 was large, very, very large, in fact. On the other hand, if I just consider this one, omega P1, which is the pole frequency at node 1, which we consider to be the input node. So that was equal to 1 upon R1 C1, and C1 was considered to be the effective value of the capacitor at the input node. And because of the Miller magnification, the C1 has been increased tremendously. And that's why this R1 C1 product was large and omega P1 was small. So we have made this assumption that since R1 C1 was much, much larger as compared to R2 C2 because of the Miller magnification. So omega P1 is much, much smaller than omega P2. And then we have made this dominant pole approximation. Now that was possible in common source stage because there was a Miller magnification. Now if I assume that these values of the capacitors are almost comparable to each other, CGD, CGS, and CSB, and so on. So in that case, you'll find that there is no such Miller magnification taking place. You can always apply Miller's theorem. So this dominant pole approximation is not at all valid. So until and unless you know the exact value for these different capacitors, and obviously the transconductance and the input resistance that you have considered like RG, you cannot find out the expression for, or you cannot find out the node frequency. So for a common drain kind of topology, it is always preferable that you should go by the formal approach, that is a traditional approach, where you can simply find out the expression for the transfer function using the small signal equivalent model of the source follower circuit. Now, let me just consider the other type of the topology for a MOS amplifier, and that was common gate. Now, as you understand, for a common gate type of amplifier, in fact, in the last class, I have also mentioned that so for a common gate amplifier, there was no such Miller effect. both for common source and common drain, there was a Miller effect, but the capacitors were different. For common source test, the capacitor was CGD, capacitor between the gate and the drain. And for a common drain, it was CGS, that is the capacitor between the gate and the source. However, while discussing the fundamental idea of associating the capacitors for three different topology of a MOS amplifier, I mentioned that for a common gate amplifier, for CG stage, CG configuration, there was no such Miller effect because you didn't find any capacitor which was connected between the input and the output node. So let me just start with the discussion with the typical common gate amplifier. Once again, as you know, for a common gate amplifier, the gate is considered to be common. That means a DC ground, and the input is applied at the source end, and the output is obtained from the drain end. So let me just bias this gate end with a fixed value, let it be VB, and let us apply the input signal through a resistance at this node, that is the source end. And let me call this resistance to be RS. And obviously, we'll be collecting the output from this terminal because this is the output terminal for a common gate topology. And we have a drain supply over here, that is VDD, and we do have a resistance. So let us start our discussion with a discrete resistance like RD, and later on we can simply replace this RD by means of a current source kind of. So under this condition, first of all, you have to identify the capacitors which are present between the different terminals of this MOSFET. So as before, you do have one capacitor between the gate and the source, which we call CGS, and another capacitor between the gate and the drain, which we call CGD, and one capacitor between the source and the substrate, that is CSB, and another capacitor between the drain and the substrate, that is CDB. So these are the four capacitors, and none of the capacitors can be thrown at me, because if you just take a look at the different potentials and the two plates of the capacitor, so here for CSB, one plate is at the source end and the other plate is at the AC ground. So source is not obviously at, source is not at all at AC ground. So obviously you do have CSB over here active in the circuit. What about CGS? One end is at AC ground, because whenever you are feeding this MOS with a constant supply, with a constant potential like VB, so in the AC equivalent circuit, it will be at AC ground, small signal circuit. But the other end is at the source. So therefore, we cannot get rid of CGS. What about CDB? So one end is at AC ground, the other end is at the output terminal. And for CGD, one end is at AC ground and the other end is at output terminal. So just by observing these four different capacitors, what we can identify is that we can club them together. We can merge the capacitors. So for example, I'm just marking with, say, dot, this CGS and this CSB, they can be merged together, and this CGD and CDB, they can be merged together. So this effective capacitor, so what I can do is I can once again draw the circuit. So now the effective capacitor between these two end, so this is AC ground. You can make it a AC ground. This is a small signal circuit to some extent. And we are applying the input here. This one is RD. So now you can identify the different capacitors. So from source to ground, we have an effective capacitance that is equal to CGS plus CSP. And from, so this is the output terminal, so I should mention it over here. So this one is the output terminal Vout. And the effective capacitance over here. Is CGD plus CDB, because these two capacitors are coming in shunt in parallel, so the effective value is nothing but the addition of these two, the equivalent capacitor, as you know. So now the circuit is simplified like this. We do have two capacitor. So initially we have started with four capacitors, and now none of the capacitors can be thrown away, but they can be paired together. So at the input end, so this is the input terminal. So you have to identify which one is input node and which one is output node. So this is the input node, and this one is output node. So accordingly, we have to identify the equivalent capacitor at the input node to ground, and the equivalent resistance between the input node to ground. Now, while doing this nodal analysis, once again, I'm just mentioning the rule. You have to make all the independent source equal to zero. So first of all, you just take a look at the input node over here. So I'm considering, suppose let me call this as say, let it be say node A, and this as say node B. So at node A, whenever you are trying to find out the frequency, so you have to identify the effective value of the capacitor between node A and AC ground, and the effective value of the resistance between node A and AC ground. So the effective value of the capacitor at node A is nothing but CGS plus CSB. And what about the effective value of the resistance? So one thing is very clear, since in this particular calculation, this Vin is made zero, because you have to make all the independent sources equal to zero while finding out this time constant. So one path is through this. So this one is RS. This one is RS. So sitting at node A, the effective capacitor was CGS plus CSB. And regarding the effective resistance, one path is obviously through RS. From A to ground, you have this RS. And because of the MOS itself, because of this transistor, you have another impedance or another resistance offered by the MOS. You know that in the small signal equivalent circuit, the effective value of the resistance shown by the MOS is given by 1 upon GM. So from gate to source, the input was, if I call the input to be Vx, and if I consider the current to be Ix, then accordingly you can easily find out between the gate to source the effective value of the impedance is given by simply 1 upon Gm. Now here obviously we are just neglecting the body effect, because otherwise we have to incorporate 1 upon Gmb also. But if I just simply neglect the body effect, then sitting at A, there are basically two different resistances, and these two are coming in shunt path. One is through this down path from A to ground in the form of RS, and another is through this path from A to ground, and this is because of the MOS itself, and that is equal to 1 upon GM. So what will be the effective value of the resistance looking at node A to ground? That is nothing but 1 upon GM parallel RS. So now you can simply find out, or you can simply write down the omega p in, that is equal to, already you have found out the equivalent R and equivalent C, so this is nothing but 1 upon RC. So R was like RS parallel 1 upon GM, and C was CGS plus CSP. So that is the equivalent RC value, and 1 upon RC will give you the corresponding pole frequency at node A. And what about omega P out? So in order to find out this omega P out, so once again I can assume that this R naught of this transistor is pretty large, so you can simply neglect this one. So then the calculation will be pretty simple. So here you find that sitting at node B, the effective value of the capacitor was nothing but CGD plus CDV, and the effective value of resistance is nothing but RT, because I'm assuming that the R naught is very large. That means there is no resistance. I mean, even if the resistance is connected, that value is very large. So since it is connected in the shunt path with RT, so I can simply neglect this R naught. So the effective resistance looking at node B to ground is nothing but RT. So then you can find out this omega P out just by inverting, I mean, finding out the reciprocal of effective R and effective C and the output node, and that we can call like omega P out, and that is given by 1 upon RD into CGD plus CDB. Now, once again, if you just compare this expression with what you have got with the common source states, once again, you have seen that there is no such Miller magnification. You have only CGS and CSB, CGS plus CSB here, and this RS parallel 1 upon GM. So we can consider that these two can be almost comparable. So accordingly, you can find out the equivalent value of RC at the input node. So the main point is that there is no such Miller magnification taking place, because you don't find any capacitor which is connected between the input and the output terminal, unless it's a short channel device. So here the input is applied at the source end, the output is applied at the output is obtained from the drain end. So had there been a connection between the drain and the source in the form of R naught or in the form of some capacitor, so you can get rid of Miller effect. So I'm assuming R naught is pretty large. R naught is let it be infinite. And for a long channel device, the value of CDS can also be neglected. But if you are interested in a short channel device, so in that case, you have to consider the effect of CDS as well. So the bottom line is that there is no such magnification in the capacitor value, neither at the input end nor at the output end, neither at the source nor at the drain. So therefore, the effective RC time constant, what you are getting, is small as compared to what you have got with the common source stage. Now, since the RC time constant is small, so 1 upon RC, that is the reciprocal of RC, will be large as compared to the common source stage. So from this analysis, you can simply understand that if you have a common gate stage and if you have a common source stage, without loss of any generality, if you just compare the speed limitation or the maximum bandwidth offered by each of these two stages, since the RC time constant is small for a common gate stage, so therefore the circuit can respond at a faster rate with respect to a common source stage. Or in other words, what we can say is this common gate stage will produce higher bandwidth, or it can provide the amplification to signals having higher frequency as compared to that of common source stage. In fact, the same observation you have also made in electronic circuits course, where we have seen that this magnification of the the capacitor C mu was absent for a common base amplifier, while it was present for a common emitter amplifier. So almost the same analysis or almost the same observation you can also see over here. And you can just by observation, obviously this calculation will be a kind of approximation because you are just finding out the pole frequency by intuition through nodal analysis. But if you are accurate enough, then once again you have to draw the small signal equivalent circuit and you have to find out the expression for the transfer function by writing V out upon V in as a function of S, and accordingly you can find out the expression for the transfer function and the different pole frequency. Now, in fact, this circuit is pretty simple, what we have discussed today, this common gate state involving a MOS device and a drain resistance. Now, what if we substitute this resistance, this load, by means of a current source device? So instead of having a simple resistive kind of load here in the form of RD, what will happen if I just substitute this RD by means of a current source load? So will there be any change in the frequency response, or will there be any change in the corresponding pole frequency? So you have to identify. So the same topology, what you're talking about, that is a common gate stage, but this time the input, I mean, if I just consider the load is not a simple resistance, rather we do have a current source kind of load. So we have a PMOS load, PMOS current source, and then this is the input device. The lower one is input device. And we are applying the input at the source end of this common gate stage. So this one is VDD. Let me call this as MOS 1, this as MOS 2. Now look, this MOS 2 is acting like a current source. So obviously, the gate potential is constant. So let it be say VB2. And this one is acting as input device M1. In a common gate configuration, so the gate potential is at AC ground. So for biasing, it was kept at VB1. Now input is applied at the source end, and this is the resistance RS, and we'll be taking the output from this terminal Vout. So in fact, the same circuit. The only difference is this one. Instead of having a simple resistance, now you do have one PMOS current source load. Now, once you have inserted this one, obviously for some reason, otherwise you should not incorporate this MOS over here. But once you insert this MOS, obviously the performance of the circuit is limited because of the presence of the capacitors. So first of all, you have to identify the different capacitors. So those four capacitors, so that will be there obviously, like CGS1, CGD1, this one is CDB1, and this one is CSB1. Now that is for M1 only. But apart from that, since you have inserted M2, so obviously the effect of the capacitors resulting from M2 needs to be considered. So you do have this one, which is CGD2. You have this one, which is CGS2. And it will limit the performance of the overall circuit. And then you have this capacitor. We call this capacitor like CSB2, and this capacitor as CdV2. So I can extend this one. I can extend this capacitor for the sake of convenience. It was CdV2. So now in the circuit we have 8 capacitors: CgS1, CgS2, CgD1, CgD2, CsB1, CsB2, CdV1, CdV2. So first of all, you have to check whether any of the capacitors can be thrown away. Now you can get rid of only those capacitors for which the potential at the two plates being the same. So one such capacitor is CsB, because one end is at the source, the other end is at AC ground, and the source is at VDD for a P-type MOS. So therefore, you can get rid of CsB2. Is there any other capacitor which you can simply neglect? Yes, this capacitor CgS2. Once again, one end is at VB2, which is at AC ground, and the other end is at VDD, which is also at AC ground. Therefore, you can also get rid of this capacitor. So, although you would have 8 capacitors to start with, now your circuit is much more simpler. And now I can once again draw the same circuit with a reduced number of capacitors. And obviously, some of them will also be merged together. So suppose this is the small signal circuit. So I can put a small signal over here like this. This is also DC ground. And you are applying the input at this end. That is Vin. This one is RS. This one I call like M1. This is M2. And we're taking the output from this end. Now let us check whether any of the capacitors can be merged or not. So first, take a look at CsB1 and CgS1. They are sharing a common terminal, that is the source one of MOS1, S1, and the other end is at AC ground. So therefore, we can simply these two can be combined, CgS1 and CsB1, and ultimately we do have one capacitor, effective value of which is CgS1 plus CsB1. Anything else? Yes, now you can take a look at this capacitor, CdB, CgD1, CdB1, CgD2, and CdV2. So all of them are sharing a common terminal, which is the drain terminal of MOS1 and MOS2, because MOS1 and MOS2, M1 and M2, they are sharing a common drain. And each of these, all of the four capacitors, CdB1, CdV2, CgD1, and CgD2, they are connected to the drain end at one side and to the ground at the other side. So therefore, all these four can be, all these four, CgD1, CgD2, CdB1, and CdV2, all of them can be connected together. Now this capacitor is like, I should write over here. So this capacitor is CgD1 plus, let me just try whether it can be completed within that CgD1, or it would be better if I write from this side. So the effective value is CgD1 plus CdB1 plus CgD2 plus CdV2. So this is the effective capacitor. So initially we have started with 8 such capacitors, 4 for each of the two transistors. And now out of that, initially 2 have been thrown away because of their nature because of their presence in the circuit. And out of these six, four can be bundled together over here in the form of this one, CGD1 plus CGDV1 plus CGD2 plus CGDV2. And these two can be bundled together, CGS1 plus CGS1. Now with this, we have to proceed with the same type of analysis which we have just now made. So the first thing is that you have to identify. So the two nodes, obviously the same two nodes are here also. So I may call this as node A and this as node B. And sitting at node A, you have to identify what is the effective value of the resistance between node A to ground, what is the effective value of the capacitor between node A to ground. And the same analysis is also to be carried out at node B. Now, what happened for node A? So for node A, if you do the analysis, at node A, in fact, I can write like omega PA. So you have to identify what is effective resistance, what is effective capacitor. In fact, the same analysis which we have done in the last circuit, the effective resistance was like RS parallel 1 upon GM, or 1 upon GM1 rather, because this time we have two different MOS, M1 and M2. And the effective capacitor was CGS1 plus CSB1. So omega PA is nothing but 1 upon this RC time constant. So already we have got this one, that is RS parallel 1 upon GM1. It should be 1 because it is coming from the first MOS. And it will be CGS1 plus CSB1, that is the effective capacitor between node A and ground. Now, what about the effective value of, what about the time constant at node B? Now, while performing this analysis, you can consider two different situations. One situation is when the value of R0 is very large. That means the output impedance provided by each of these two MOS devices are pretty large. Remember, this time, instead of having simple RD, we do have a PMOS type of current source, PMOS current source. And if the current source is ideal, then you understand the output impedance provided by this current source is nothing but infinite. So in effect, you can think of a situation where a resistance is connected between this node B and this ground, whose value is equal to RO2. And this RO2, if it is equal to infinite, then what about the effective time constant? That will be infinite because R is infinite and you have some finite value of C over here. This one, CGD1 plus CDB1 plus CGD2 plus CDB2. So the effective value of the time constant will be equal to infinite for lambda to be equal to 0. And therefore, the corresponding node frequency will be equal to 0. So you have a pole at S is equal to 0. So that is the scenario when you are considering lambda to be 0. So with lambda is equal to 0, that means R0 equal to infinite, with lambda is equal to 0, you find that omega PB is equal to, is coming to be 0, because this RC time constant is becoming infinite because of R0 to be equal to infinite. But what happens when R0 is not equal to infinite? So then we have to once again, I think we need to draw the circuit once more. So now I'm saying that R0 is not equal to infinite. So we have a finite output resistance. So let me just draw the circuit once again. So these are the two MOS. This is at AC ground. Now we are supplying now. Let us do one thing. Let us now change the orientation of the input, let it be applied over here, the same thing. And we do have an effective capacitor whose value is equal to CGS1 plus CSB1. And this is the output terminal, Vout. And we do have a capacitor whose value was CGD1 plus CDB1 plus CGD2 plus CDB2. So now, once again, let me just point out these two nodes. This is node A. So our job with node A is over. And this is node B. So now let us assume that lambda is greater than zero. Lambda is not equal to zero. Lambda is greater than zero. That means the channel length modulation exists. So we have to take into account the effect of channel length modulation when lambda is greater than zero. That means what we can think of is we do have a resistance whose value is finite, which is connected between the drain and source of this. So let me call this like RO2, and let us have another such resistance, which is connected between drain and source. And in fact, if you just look at this RO1, you'll find that this RO1 makes an interaction between the input terminal and the output terminal. Because of this RO1, you do have a connection between node A and node B. So now, being at node B, sitting at node B, you have to identify the effective capacitance and the effective resistance. The effective capacitance we have already calculated in the form of CGD1 plus CDB1, this big capacitor, the summation of these four capacitors. Now, what about the effective value of the resistance? So sitting at node B, the effective resistance between node B to ground, you do have two paths. One is upward path, second one is downward path. So in the upward path, you do have this resistance, RO2. Node B, RO2, ground. So you do have one path over here. What about the downward path? From B, you do have this connection, this RO1, B to A. But take a look at the fact that node A is not at AC ground. Rather, I can consider this potential to be at AC ground, because whenever we will perform this nodal analysis, all the independent voltage and the current source should be zero. So Vin should be zero. So therefore, this is equal to zero while performing the nodal analysis or while calculating the effective resistance sitting at node B. So what is this one, RO1, fine, but node A is not at AC ground. AC ground is this point. So how to find out the effective resistance in the downward path? It is nothing but a simple common source stage with a source degeneration. And that time we have already calculated the output resistance. And that output resistance was, if you can remember, this R out, if I say like R out 1, for a common source stage with source degeneration, it was like 1 plus GM1 RO1 times RS plus RO1. 1 plus GM1 RO1 times RS plus RO1. So that is the effective resistance between node B to ground in the downward path. So you can think that you do have a resistance like this. You can think that you would have a resistance like this. From this terminal to ground, you would have a resistance like this, whose value is equal to RO1. So now, at point B, you have two different resistances. One is RO2 in the upward path, and the second one is RO1 in the downward path. So therefore, if we want to find out this omega P at node B, so this is nothing but 1 upon the effective R into effective C. So R effective is nothing but R out one in parallel with R out two, and the capacitor is like this big one, CGD one plus CDB one plus CGD two plus CDB two. In fact, that calculation is not also perfect, because while finding out this R out one in this expression, we have simply neglected the effect of the CGS one plus CSB one. Because while discussing the concept of a source degeneration in unit number 3, we have simply not considered any capacitor over here. But this time, as you can find between source to ground here, because this is a DC ground, we can source to ground, you not only have one resistance RS, but also you do have another capacitor in the form of CGS1 plus CSB1. So therefore, this expression, what we have written over here, this RS, so instead of having RS, that gets modified because we have not considered this effect of the CGS1 plus CSB1. So rather, you should have RS with the parallel combination of 1 upon S CGS1 plus CSB1. So the effective capacitor over here is CGS1 plus CSB1. So what will be the effective impedance? It will be 1 upon SC. So 1 upon S CGS1 plus CSB1. And that is coming in shunt with RS. And this entire thing is getting multiplied with 1 plus GM1 R1 plus R1 will give you R out 1. So that will be the exact expression for R out 1 if I want to take the CGS1 plus CSB1 into account. So in fact, you have seen that this CGS1 plus CSB1 was there for the calculation of the pole frequency at node A. However, if I consider that we do have a finite value of R1 and R2. So in that case, and if you're accurate enough, then you cannot get rid of this capacitor during the calculation of time constant at node B as well. And accordingly, what you find is omega P out, or rather omega PB, is given by 1 upon this one, this value. Once again, if you just compare, I think in this slide, I can once again write down this expression, omega PA. So that was like 1 upon, let me just summarize, RS parallel 1 upon GM1 into CGD1, sorry, it will be CGS1, CGS1 plus CSB1. So unless you know the exact value of these capacitors like CGS, CSB, and CDB, and I mean CDB1 and CDB2. So unless you know all these 6 capacitors, the CGS1, CSB1, CGD1, CDB1, CGD2, and CDB2, and unless you know this value of the output resistance and the mutual conductance, then you cannot simply find out the value of omega P and omega PB. And you cannot say which one is larger, because it essentially depends upon the exact value of those capacitors. So you don't find there is a Miller magnification over here also, right? So in fact, this R out one is large with respect to R out two, because there is magnification, and that is one of the biggest advantage of having source degeneration. The input, I mean, the impedance has been increased, so output impedance is getting multiplied with this GM one times R one. So that is obviously one advantage over here. But whenever you are making a parallel path over here, R out one parallel R out two, R out two, then this shunt resistance will be generally governed by the minimum of the two, right? And if I consider that these capacitors are almost comparable, then you ought to know which one is larger, whether omega PA is larger or omega P2 is larger. Then you have to put the exact value for those resistance and the capacitance, and then you can simply find out the expression for, I mean, the value for omega PA and omega PB. But one thing is very sure from the frequency response analysis of common gate stage is that since there is no magnification of the capacitor by virtue of the Miller effect, so the circuit is faster, time constant is small, RC time constant is small, so circuit is faster as compared to common source stage. Or in other words, the bandwidth provided by the common gate stage is getting amplified or is more as compared to what you have achieved with a common source stage. So in this lecture, I have basically discussed about the frequency response, high frequency response of common drain stage, which is also known as source follower, by using the traditional transfer function based approach, and also for common gate stage using the nodal analysis. So two circuits, the common drain and common gate, two circuits were analyzed from two different perspectives. Now with this, I would like to conclude this lecture on frequency response of MOS amplifier.